Okay, let's get started. So today I'm going to talk more about memory management to fill in some of the remaining loose ends and talk about some optimizations in real systems like Linux and other Unix operating systems. And this is covered partially in the chapter in the book that talks about the VAX VMS operating system, but some of it is extra stuff. All right, so a couple announcements. I'm sure you saw that I posted a practice midterm exam, and there are answers that go along with that. So the real exam is going to be pretty similar to that. So I hope that this helps you to focus on what to study on. And you'll see that I chose specifically to focus on topics that were not covered by the projects. So specifically, like the fork system call and those related system calls and non-determinism, which we're going to talk more about in later sections of the class. But the basic functionality of fork is going to be sort of covered. We'll, like, you know, look at a section of code and tell me what happens. So please understand that. And then there's a section on scheduling, which gives you some processes that want to do certain things, and you have to show what various scheduling policies will decide. And there's also a section on free lists, and all those topics were not really covered in the projects. Okay. I also decided to just go ahead and make the exam open book and open notes, because why not? I don't think that'll really help you that much, I guess, because there's only a limited amount of time for you to take the exam. So if you're spending all your time reading the book, yeah, you're not going to actually have time to answer the questions. But if you happen to have a copy of the book, then bring it along. I also made a printable slide deck, because, you know, my slides are black background, white text. It's really, like, if you print them out, it wastes a lot of ink. So I made an inverted version of those slides and, like, took all the slides together for the whole first half and removed some of the uninteresting announcement slides and made a single PDF that's 49 pages that you might want to print out and bring to the exam. That was in an announcement. It's also, I think, on the syllabus or in the file section of the Canvas page. Okay, so that's the first of announcements. Anything about the midterm? I think that we'll have time at the end of this lecture to go through specifically. If you have questions about the practice midterm questions, I think I can address those in more detail later. Yes? I won't be testing you specifically on the project stuff, like asking you to redo anything in the projects or asking you to revisit any of the solutions to the projects, but theoretically, I could show you code that was from XV6. Like, even in the practice midterm, I showed you some code from the malloc and free implementation of XV6. And so potentially there could be code that you worked on for the projects. But like I said, I'm going to focus on these areas that were not covered in the projects. So it would be better to just focus on, I think, what you see in the practice midterm and the closely related topics. It's not going to be identical, but the same kind of topics. And same format for the questions, I think. So make sure you're familiar with the question formats I used in the practice exam. Okay. The other thing I wanted to mention is if any of you saw a zero grade in Project 1, don't freak out. Just talk to the TA. That was really a procedural error. Those really should have been blank, because some people, like, submitted patch files that didn't work for whatever reason. And the instructions for making the patch file were not great, so I don't really blame you for that. But you just have to somehow get a working version of your code to the TA, Yingyi, and you know, you'll get a proper grade for that project if you can get your code over there. Okay. So, and like I said, do read chapter 23 on the VAX VMS virtual memory system. It would even be helpful to do that before the exam, even though I didn't list chapter 23 on that list of chapters that are covered. But it's really just kind of a review of all the topics in memory management that we've covered so far as they apply to a specific system. So it's actually a good way of reviewing. Reading chapter 23 is a good way of reviewing all the virtual memory chapters. Okay. All right. So last lecture I talked about swapping, and the basic idea was that you have this disk in most machines that is slow but large, especially in a traditional like desktop or server machine that has a magnetic disk. On a laptop or a smartphone or a tablet, the disks are still pretty large, but they're solid state, so they're not as slow. But the same basic principle applies, where you have additional storage available on a disk, and you can use that to store the overflow from RAM, so stuff that you can't fit in RAM. And we saw that magnetic disks have high throughput, but high latency. So high throughput is good. You can transfer lots of bits per second in parallel, sort of. But there's a long delay before you can get the first bit of data, because there's essentially a long distance to travel and some mechanical action that has to happen before you can start reading. And paging and swapping work together using the same CPU mechanism. So basically, the not present bit in the page table is how the OS sets up the page tables, so that the CPU creates a page fault when a certain page, certain section of memory is read. That section of memory could be faulted either because it's an invalid page, which is what we talked about earliest, but it also could fault because that memory has been swapped to disk. Okay, and the OS can sort of recognize that. Particularly, the OS can use the high bits of the page table entry to store a disk location or other information about about that page table entry. So it can make a decision when there is a page fault on how to handle it. Okay. Generally, a page replacement policy is what we call the code that decides which page to evict to free memory, because generally with swapping, you need to decide which memory is going to be, which parts of various programs are going to be in physical memory versus swapped on disk. Okay. And swapping can happen either on demand or in the background. On demand means that you wait until you really need the space. So you have a page fault and you need to handle it somehow, and you need to kick someone out to make space for the new page. But in the background is a little bit nicer, because it's a policy where you make sure you always have some space available in physical memory, so that whenever any process requests a page, that request can actually happen immediately, because there's some space available. There's no delay for those allocations. But it does mean that you have a little bit of like wasted space that's just always free, right? But what you do in the background with background swapping is you just make sure you always have at least a certain amount of free space in physical memory. Okay. So about mechanisms, I mentioned an accessed bit and a dirty bit in the page table entries, which the CPU can, if it's, which most CPUs, it's in particular the Intel x86 architecture, will set an access bit or a dirty bit when it reads or writes to a page of memory. And that allows the OS to know kind of what's going on, what has been going on with memory accesses. Because normally when there's a memory read or write, you know, the OS is not involved. It's limited direct execution. The read and write to memory is something that a process can do on its own without any interference from the OS. But the OS still would like to get some information about the general access pattern. And these accessed and dirty bits in the page table entries are a way for the CPU to provide some coarse level detail about what's going on with memory access that the OS can access later. Okay. Finally, there's a name thrashing for the condition when the system is like just doing a lot of swapping, and really just doing swapping, because you have a lot of processes that are demanding way more memory than you have available, and all your time is spent just shuffling data between the swap space and the main memory, and no one can really get any work done. And in that situation, you're kind of hosed. Like you basically need to kill some processes and give up, because it's better to. You may have like 10 processes that are all trying to make progress. No one's making any progress because there's so much swapping going on, and it would be better to kill like maybe half of those to allow the other half to actually get some work done. Okay. Any questions about swapping from last lecture? Okay, let's move on. So I want to make one clarification on page table addressing, because I was revisiting this slide, and I remember there was a question from someone about the bits here, and I think at the time I may not have fully answered that question. And even apart from that, I think this is kind of confusing. This was a little confusing to me when I revisited it, so I thought I should explain it again. So specifically, so this is our friend, like the two-level page table. From this is actually from the Intel manual. But you remember how you take a virtual address and you split it into three chunks. The lowest chunk is used for the offset within the page. But then the top two parts of the address are used first, the highest one, to find the page directory entry, like the top-level page table entry. And then inside that page directory entry at the high level, that'll tell you where to find the page table that you use the middle bits to index into to find the page, the actual physical address here that you add the offset to get your actual memory location. So that was the two-level paging. And the thing I thought was a little confusing about this was the number of bits being passed in these various addresses. So like these numbers next to the arrows indicate how many bits are being passed. And if you were really careful, looking at this, it may have been confusing to you what was going on in the middle here, and even at the end here. But so the highest level, it's pretty simple. You have this CR3 register that's 32 bits that indicates where the page directory starts, and then there's 4,096 entries in here, or 4,096 bits, 1,024 entries, because each entry is 4 bytes. So 10 bits allows you to access any of the entries here. But once you get here, the question, what might be confusing is why you only need 20 bits to find the location of the page table, right? Even though this address is 32 bits, right? And the answer to that question is that, so normally that actually wouldn't work if these page tables could be located anywhere in memory, because you need 32 bits to locate a memory, to specify a memory location. But the hardware actually requires you to locate your page tables so that they start at an address that has 12 zeros at the end, I think. So that these 20 bits are just the high bits of the address for the start, and you assume the rest are zeros, right? So in this page directory entry, we mentioned only the high bits are used, and the low bits were used for various flags. But the 20 bits up top are enough to find the page table entry because, like I said, the bottom 12 bits are all zeros because these page tables are aligned. They're aligned to 496 byte pages. And then the middle 10 bits here are used to index into the table. And again, you might look and say, I'm using 20 bits to find the beginning and 10 bits to index into it. That's only 30 bits, not 32. But the remaining 2 bits are all zeros because these things are four bytes long, and they are aligned to 32-bit addresses. So basically, every one of these locations ends with 2 zeros because every subsequent one is like 4 bytes later. If that makes sense. Okay, so any questions about that? Yeah. Okay, well, 4 kilobytes is, 2 to the 12 is 4 kilobytes, 4096. Because 2 to the 10 is 1024, that's an easy way to remember binary. 2 to the 10 is 1024, and then 2 more bits gives you 4 times that, so that's 4 times 1024. So here we need 12. We need 12 here, but only 10 here. We need 12 here because when the program is accessing memory, it can access like 1 byte at a time. It's byte addressable memory. So we allow it to actually use these bottom 4 bits, these bottom 2 bits, to specify like a specific byte of memory. But then here, we only use 10 bits to index into the page table, which is the same size. These are both 1 page long, 4 kilobytes. But here, like we essentially add 2 zeros to the end of this address, so that we skip every 4 when we're going through the bytes of this page table. because we know that the page table entries are 4 bytes long. Okay. Any other questions? All right, fascinating stuff. And then here, like with the deeper page table, the big pages, 4 megabyte pages, there's the same kind of weird math in this diagram where it looks like you only need 18 bits to find the start of a 4 megabyte page. And you have like 18 and 22. They don't add up to 32. They actually add up to more than 32. So what's going on here? So here again, we require these 4 megabyte pages. This is a case where we're using big pages and a linear directory. But we require the start of the address of this 4 megabyte page to be aligned to a 16 kilobyte frame, which is, so like the bottom 14 bits have to be zero of the address. And then the 22 bits kind of like overlap they could potentially, they're added to this address. They're not necessarily just adjoined left and right, but these bottom 22 bits are added to these 18 bits that have 14 zeros padded on the right side of them. If that makes sense at all. Anyway, it works out. Okay, so back to newer stuff. So, and back to swapping. So I went really quickly through a couple of things at the end of last lecture that I want to talk about in more detail here. And specifically the page replacement algorithm for swapping. And we talked about approximating least recently used. So least recently used is a very common cache policy for all kinds of caches, but it works pretty, you might want to implement it for swapping in particular. But the problem is that we don't necessarily know which pages were accessed, except we do know actually with the access bit. So I mentioned the clock algorithm where you go through all the pages until you find one that was not accessed recently. So the access bit was zero. This is not truly least recently used, but it's sort of like a way to find a page that was not recently used. Not necessarily the least recently used, but just not recently used. So in the time since you last looked at that page, because last time you looked at that page, you would have set the access bit to zero, reset it. And then you let the program run, and then, like I said, the CPU will set the access bit in the page table entry if it doesn't access. So next time you check it, you can look at that bit to determine whether or not that page was used. And if not, then it's maybe a good candidate for swapping out to disk, right? That's what I mentioned last week. What I want to mention now is what you can do, like a sort of hack to implement the same kind of algorithm if your CPU architecture doesn't set an access bit. So we don't have a bit in the page table entry that tells us whether or not the memory was accessed. And in that case, we really have no idea what memory was accessed. Okay. And this is true, this happens to have been true in the VAX architecture, which is described in that chapter 23 of the book. Okay. And I thought this was a neat little trick, and it's the kind of thing that OS designers sometimes have to do to get around hardware limitations. Especially in a system like Linux that supports dozens of different architectures. Some architectures have really good hardware support for OS features, some do not. And you'd still want to have the same kind of policies across all those different architectures, despite perhaps missing hardware mechanisms. So what you can do in that case is emulate an access bit. And specifically, you can do that using the present bit and page faults. So what do I mean? Basically, what you can do is you can go through and mark pages as not present, present bit equals zero, even if you don't plan to evict those. Like if you plan to leave the memory in use, but you just want to test to see whether anyone needs it, you can pretend that it's not there, set the present bit to zero, and then let the program run. And if the program tries to access that memory range, you know, it doesn't have an access bit to tell us later that it accessed it. But if the present bit is zero, then we know that there will be a page fault. Because the idea of a present bit is a minimum feature that has to be available if you're going to have paging at all. in your system. So we do assume that we have the present bit. Right, so we can test pages by pretending they're not there, letting the program run, and when a page fault happens, we can look at that page table entry, and if we use some of the OS reserved bits or whatever, there are ways that we can tell that the page actually is there, we're just pretending it's not by messing with the page table. And in that case, we now have, the OS now has some information about what pages have been accessed, right? And basically, so you can think about this as a second chance scheme. So if you want to implement a clock algorithm, like if you want to approximate least recently used, but you don't know which pages are being accessed, what you can do is you can go through the pages, and when you see a page, you can say, okay, I want to evict this particular page, but I don't know if it's been read, so I'm going to give it a second chance. Like, I'm going to try to evict it. I'm going to pretend I evicted it, basically. So set the present bit to zero, and then let the program run. I mean, in that case, you haven't actually done anything useful because you haven't freed up any space, so you can't do this if you really need the space. But you can do that, pretend it was evicted, and then check again later, and if there wasn't a page fault that caused you to reset the present bit to one, then you know that actually it's pretty safe to go ahead and evict that page because you gave it a trial run, it wasn't used, and so it had its second chance, and it didn't use the second chance, so it can go. Okay, questions about that? Well, what you do, in this case, when I talk about setting the present bit to one, the idea is that if you have a page fault, that means that someone tried to use that memory. And if the present bit was set to zero, but in fact you have some other bits in the page table entry, or you have a data structure in your kernel memory somewhere that tells you that you're just testing this page, you haven't really evicted this page yet. In that case, you know that this page has been recently used. So you set present to one, and by doing that, you've kind of removed it from that list of candidates that are being tested for eviction, right? Okay. So another optimization is copy on write, specifically with fork. So remember that fork is the way that we clone a process, and usually if you're creating a new process, out of an existing process, you both fork and then you exec. So like the fork creates a clone of your current process totally, and then exec pulls in the code from a binary file in the file system and loads that code kind of into your current process to kick off that new program, right? But like I said, fork clones the entire process. This includes all the virtual memory. So theoretically, this could be very slow and inefficient. So specifically, if you think about like a large program that's running and it wants to create a background job to do something with fork, like it wants to write something to disk in the background, so it does a fork and then it's going to do an exec to like overwrite it. Or maybe it's not even going to do an exec, it's just going to do a fork and then run some code that's in the main binary, but it wants to do that in a separate process so it can happen in the background. So that, like I said, that fork would be very slow if all the memory had to be copied. But it's very common that you're not going to use all the parent's memory because often you're going to just call exec to overwrite everything anyway. Or you're only going to run a little bit of code to do a little bit of work that's unrelated to the main code bits for the rest of the process. Okay. So we'd like to somehow do a fork without doing a copy, like a full copy. And the solution to that on Unix systems is called copy on write. So again, this is something where the OS like pretends to perform an action, but doesn't really do it. It does something different, and then later on, it has to kind of fix things up so that the semantics of the program still are what the program expects, right? But basically, what happens here is when you do a fork, you don't actually actually have to copy all the parents' pages initially. You can try to share them, okay? So remember with page tables, you can have multiple page tables point to the same page in memory. Like obviously Project 2 has you implement shared memory. That's the idea here. So when there's a fork, you could, in the child process, in the child process's page table, make all of those entries, like duplicate the page table of the parent essentially, and have all the child's page table entries point to the parent's memory pages. You can't stop there. Like, you can't actually allow the parent and child to use the same memory because there's a difference between sharing memory and cloning memory, right? Theoretically, these two processes should have copies that they can each manipulate separately. So if the first process changes something, the second process should not see the change, right? But if we make these pages read-only, which we can do in the page table entries, at least temporarily, so we make all the parents' pages read-only, then we know that there won't be any problems as far as the processes affecting each other in ways that they shouldn't, like one process writing data that the other one shouldn't be able to see. But then once we do that, we do actually want to allow the processes to write to their own data. We can't leave it read-only forever, but we temporarily set everything to read-only. And then basically once we start seeing page faults that are related to processes trying to write to data to pages that we've marked as read-only, we can then decide whether or not that is a true violation or that's a violation that we artificially created because we created this read-only sharing that actually wasn't supposed to be there in the first place. You see what I mean? So if either the parent or the child writes to one of these shared read-only pages, the CPU will cause an exception, and the OS handles the exception by copying the page. And now both the parent and the child have a copy, and marking those pages is writable for both the parent and the child, because they now have their own copy. But then this can happen like lazily on demand whenever writes happen. You make the guess ahead of time that processes are not going to need, that the child process is not going to need all the memory from the parent process. But then when it does actually need certain parts, you make the copies in response to page faults. Okay? That makes sense? So that's pretty clever. A related optimization is demand zeroing. So that you can think of that, we can think of copy and write as a form of lazy allocation of memory. And this is another form of lazy allocation. When we talk about lazy in operating systems, we mean like delaying work, right? So if a process asks for more memory with SBREAK or MMAP, so remember, you probably have seen by now in Project 2 that SBREAK is used to like expand the page table for a given process so that it can start using more memory addresses within its range, because initially the processes are set up so that even though technically they have the full memory address range, they'll actually get exceptions if they access more memory than the OS expects. And then MMAP, which we haven't really seen that because it's not an XV6, but this is like the more modern equivalent of SBREAK, where MMAP allows the kernel to return like a block of virtual memory to the in a random location, provide a block of memory to the process for it to use, and that allows like the memory to be expanded not just from the bottom up, but kind of like in random locations. Anyway, so just know that processes are going to ask for memory at various points, and when they do that, we may want to think about being lazy. And not doing it immediately. So if we don't do the full allocation immediately, we can minimize the latency of fulfilling these requests. So the process asks for more memory, and we immediately say, okay, you have it, even though we haven't really done anything in the virtual memory system to set it up. That allows the program to continue working on, and that works well if the program is just kind of like is a little bit too eager or greedy in allocating memory. It may allocate memory that it doesn't necessarily need immediately or may never need. And so it allows the OS to like make things a little faster, but also save space because it prevents it from allocating memory that's not actually going to be used. So what you do is, you know, similar to the copy on write, what you do is you end up reacting to page faults on these areas of memory that were supposedly allocated. And then at that point, you allocate physical frames. And another thing that, so specifically with not just demand-based allocation, but zeroing. So just keep in mind that when the OS gives memory to, gives new physical frames to processes, like when a process asks for memory and the OS picks out a chunk of physical memory to give to that process, it's actually a really good idea to write zeros to that memory because that memory has been used previously by other processes and we don't want to leak data from other processes. That's a security concern, okay? Even though technically, when you write a program, you have no expectation that there are gonna be zeros across the whole memory address space. If you do a read in a random location, you should expect there to be a random value there. You shouldn't write your programs to expect zeros. But for security reasons, we don't want to allow programs to read data that may have been used by other programs. There could be a password in there or whatever, right? All right, so I guess my point is that the OS has to write out the zeros to that full page, and it has to allocate a physical frame when a process requests more memory, but it doesn't really have to do that until there's a page fault indicating that the process really tried to use that memory, right? Okay. So there's some handy tools on Linux in particular and on other systems to check out what's going on with the virtual memory. On Linux, the pmap command shows a process's virtual memory mapping. I'm gonna show you a screenshot of that in the next slide. And it shows, I mean, one of the reasons that Linux has a lot of lines of code is that it provides a lot of information. It doesn't just provide basic functionality, but also provides a lot of reporting, like provides information to users to see what's going on within the kernel in really user-friendly ways. Like for example, there's this proc file system, and there's also a sys file system. So if slash proc and slash sys are like virtual folders that exist on a Linux machine that don't really store data that's on a disk, but just are a virtual interface where you can, basically you can look at virtual files here that actually reflect information about the system rather than reflecting data that's on a disk, right? So if you know your process ID, you can spit out the contents of this file slash proc slash process ID slash smaps to see a lot of details about the virtual memory mapping for that process, right? And when we look at the output from pmap or from smap, smap has more detail, but just pmap, if we start with pmap, we can see that the OS tracks like which file code is loaded from, so that it can load a little bit of the file first, a little bit of the code first, and then load the rest of it lazily as needed. So both binaries, like the actual executable file and libraries, they're dynamically linked. These are both lazily loaded, and in the OS memory management system, there's a record of like what file did this page come from. You'll see that in the next slide. And they're also marked, libraries are marked, you know, read-only in some cases, so they can be shared with other processes. So here's an output from pmap. So what I did was, on Murphy, I loaded Emacs in one window, and in another window, I ran pmap on the process ID for that Emacs instance. And this shows, this actually was like, 3 or 4 screens long. It's actually a lot longer than this. But because there are a lot of libraries being used by Emacs, it's a complicated program. But this gives you an idea of what's going on in the virtual memory of this program. This happens to be a pretty complicated program. But on the left, that first column is the virtual memory address. You can see this is a 64-bit machine, so there are like 16, I think, hexadecimal characters to represent the address. And somewhere near the bottom of the address space, there are like 10 megabytes of pages, so the 2 kilobytes plus 8 kilobytes, that came from this Emacs file, like the actual binary file. And one section of it is read and execute only. the other section of it is read and write. So this first map, this first segment here is the code, right? Because it's read and write, execute only, it's not writable. And the second segment, because we can see it's writable and not executable, that's probably the global data for the program, okay? Then after it, you see there's this page marked, not page, but it's actually several pages. You can see the size is 1.2 megabytes. There's this other section of data that is marked anon, which means anonymous. In this case, it just means the kernel doesn't know where this memory came from. Like, it didn't come from a file. It's anonymous. In this case, it's probably the a part of the heap for the Emacs process. So when Emacs first started, it may have created some heap space up here. And then there are all these libraries, shared libraries. libuuid, libsm, libgif, ld, the linker. libc is a big one used by a lot of the programs. libnss, blah, blah, blah. There are many other libraries between here. And then at the very end, so you see how the addresses keep going up. Near the bottom, it gets pretty high. But there's one special section here marked stack. That's the stack memory, as you might expect. And it's read and writable. And in this case, it's 164 kilobytes is the total size so far. Okay. Now, what this shows is a summary of the page table for the Emacs process with some additional information that the OS is tracking, so which it uses to service page faults. So if there's a page fault in these sections of memory are not necessarily, these page table entries don't necessarily map to physical pages. They could be swapped out to disk, but these are all the parts of the page table that the OS knows about, and it also has the information necessary for the OS to service page faults, for example, by loading in additional code from these files, right? Like the binary file, when it gets to new parts of the Emacs binary that it hasn't executed before, it probably will not have loaded that stuff into memory, so there'll be a page fault. If there's a page fault in this range between 400000 and whatever, then the OS knows that it can get that data from the Emacs file. But one thing I want to point out is that each of the shared libraries has several different sections of pages, and they have different permissions. So there's the read and executable part. You can imagine is the code because it's executable. There's a part that's just readable. Actually, most of the libraries don't have that, but this one does. Libc has one. LD does. But like libsm just has three. The readable section, you can imagine, might just be for constants, like string constants that are generated at compile time, like data that's not going to change. And then there's a section that's readable and writable, which is the global data for that library, for this particular instance of the library, I guess, you know, for this process's copy of that library. And then weirdly, there's a page for every one of these, I think. Not everyone, but for a lot of them. Like, LD doesn't have one, but for libnss, there's this page that has, like, no permissions. Not page, I guess, but, like, section of memory that has no permissions. And those are guard pages. So basically, like, the kernel has decided that this address, whatever that is, for about 2 megabytes, it's going to reserve that space for libnss, but it's not going to actually allow the process to read from that area. So it's kind of set that aside for whatever reason, and that'll page fault if the program tries to read from there. And potentially, that may be used for lazy allocation, I don't know. I'm not sure. If it's, okay. Another thing I want to point out in this view is that we have two columns here for RSS and dirty. So RSS means like resident something size. So this is the amount of memory that's in physical memory for this particular segment. So of this binary, 1.3 megabytes is in physical memory, resident physical memory. And then dirty means is the number of pages from that section that have been written to. And of course, for the binary that's read-only, you don't expect any dirty pages. But then for the global data down here, you can see that a lot of it has been written to, 6,000 of the pages, of the kilobytes, have been written to of a total of about almost 9,000. Okay, so this is like various information that the kernel is tracking on the virtual memory address space for Emacs so that it can make decisions about paging. All right. Any questions? Okay, so some of that information at a higher level is presented by TOP, which is like my favorite program for just looking at the activity on a Linux machine. So specifically, we can look at shared memory. So one of the things I should have pointed out here previously was for all these libraries, you know, many of them have read-only sections. So this first one here and the second one here, like this libNSS has two different sections that are read-only. Those particular sections can be shared among different processes that are using the same library. It's the exact same code and the same constants are used every time a process uses libNSS files version 2.12, okay? So these are candidates for reuse among different processes. The kernel just has to make those page tables for the two processes map to the same page and mark them as read-only so that the sharing doesn't cause any problems. And you can see that happening here in TOP, looking at identical processes. Like, okay, so HTTPD is the Apache web server, which used to be very popular. It's still pretty popular. Slightly out of date. There's some better alternatives now. But anyway, that's unimportant. So there's a web server running on this machine and has many different processes so that it can serve requests in parallel. And you know, the binary executable used by all these processes is the same. So we would expect that a lot of the code running in these processes is the same, and it can be shared, right? Because it's read-only. And in fact, that's true, right? So we see that although the total resident memory for each of these Apache processes is about 14 megabytes, about half of that, like 7 megabytes, is shared memory. So many of these, so the overhead of loading all these HTTP processes into memory is not actually the sum of all these numbers on the left side. It's the left-hand numbers minus the right-hand numbers summed up. And the same thing is true for SSH is another server process that has many different processes so that it can work in parallel to handle many different requests from users. And again, we have a lot of shared memory proportionate to the resident memory. Now, it's also true that other processes like MySQL is a database server. This particular process has a lot of shared memory too, 14 megabytes. But as a proportion of the total, 156, it's a much smaller proportion than HTTPD. And the second thing I want to point out here is the virtual memory column, just to the left of what I highlighted. And the interesting thing is that these numbers are pretty huge. Okay, so like these Apache processes seem to be using 339 or more megabytes of virtual memory. So that corresponds, like if you were to look at the PMAP output, like the number of the address space for the process that the kernel is aware of and has mapped to something, is on the range of 337 megabytes. But in reality, like less than 10% of that amount of memory is being used physically for that process. And of that 10%, even you know half of that is shared among different processes that have identical copies of that memory. Right. So the lesson here is that processes use only a small fraction of the virtual memory that they request. Okay. So this is a good motivation for doing lazy allocation. Right. Questions about that? Okay. So one final topic. We'll keep going. Let's take a 5-minute break now. A 4-minute break. 3.5 minutes. We'll continue at 1:20. And I'll get into this. let's continue. Okay, so the next small topic is disk buffering, file system caching. So far we've seen how swapping gives the illusion that RAM is as big as the disk. But we can also work in the other direction and use file system caching to give the illusion that the disk is as fast as the RAM. So what we're talking about is basically putting pieces of the file system in memory instead of just putting pieces of memory on disk, right? So shuffling data not just in one direction, but in both directions, depending on how they're needed. And so treating memory and files kind of equally as data that programs use, and then deciding which of those two types of data, not just memory, but memory and files, which of those should be highest priority and should be put in memory, and where the process can very quickly access it versus stored on the file system. Okay. So we know that programs explicitly access three kinds of storage. So if you look at the assembly code for a program, it works with registers, it works with memory. Usually, to access memory, it has to load it into, to work on data in memory, it has to load it into registers first. And the code also works with files indirectly by using system calls to load data from files into memory, okay? And you know, you can imagine that programs would want to use files a lot because files are the only persistent data store for available to processes. Memory goes away after the program stops, right? But file I/O can be a significant performance bottleneck. Okay. Performance bottleneck. And by performance bottleneck, I mean, you know, it's the one thing in the chain that's very slow and limits system performance. And so the term bottleneck obviously comes from a bottle that has a neck that's narrow, and things can only flow out of the bottle as quickly as the size of the neck, right? So the bottleneck is the bottleneck. Okay. But particularly a disk, in a program that uses a lot of file I/O, the disk becomes a bottleneck because the disk is the slowest thing of all, right? But to improve that performance, the OS can very cleverly move recently used pages of the disk, and not really pages, but portions of the disk, into RAM, and pretend that that data is actually in the file system. But because the OS is actually positioned in the middle of all the disk requests, because remember, the disk is a shared resource. In order to access the disk, you have to do a system call. So the OS actually is the arbiter of every file system access. It can decide whether or not, like, how to service that request, whether or not to really go to the disk or to pretend to go to the disk and actually go to memory, right? So back to the same view of top, we see there's a little section up top, on the top of top, upper right, that shows the file system cache size. So these numbers here show that on this current machine, this particular machine has 128 gigs of RAM. That's a lot of RAM because it's a server. But actually the majority of it, about 83 gigabytes, is being used, is these numbers here, buffers and cached, which are kind of two different flavors of file system caching. Okay, so these big numbers here, 37 gigs and 45 gigs, represent file system data that is being stored in memory for the purposes of improving the performance of programs using those files. Okay, so those programs could just access memory instead of accessing files, those files. Even though the programs think that they're accessing the files and they're written in such a way that they're doing system calls to access files, what's actually going on is the operating system is fooling the processes. It's helping the processes by keeping copies of what's in the files in memory to service those requests very quickly, right? So we actually call this approach a unified page cache. Unified in the sense that we're considering both virtual memory and disk blocks as data equally that can be stored either in memory or in physical memory or on the disk, right? So in modern OSs, the page replacement policy has to simultaneously consider the placement of both virtual memory pages, which we've talked about, but also disk blocks in physical RAM. So the physical RAM is not just being split among processes, it's being split among processes and among like pieces of the file system that are like hot parts of the file system that are being used frequently. So when we need to make space in physical memory, we don't just choose a victim process and a page in that process. We can also choose that a certain file might be the victim, or a certain block of the disk. Right. Now, keep in mind, of course, that eventually the disk blocks do really need to be written to the disk. That process is called flushing. When you take an in-memory copy and you flush it out to the disk, it means that you actually write the contents, the copy in memory, you write it out to disk. And you need to do that eventually because you would actually do that flushing if the page is evicted, meaning that you need to reclaim that space in physical memory for someone else. In that case, the way that you do that is you write the data to disk, right? That's one natural time when you would flush. But you also might want to flush earlier than that, even if it's staying in memory, just to be sure that you won't lose that file data if the machine crashes or you lose power to the machine. So that's a safety mechanism that you might want to consider. This concept of flushing files applies not just to the caching that the OS does, but the disks themselves also do some caching. So apart at a lower level, apart from the OS, those disks, like I showed you with the spinning platter, there's also some circuitry on the bottom that has some memory that's a buffer. Like basically when you write to the disk, when the OS writes to the disk and it thinks it's truly writing to the platters, it's not necessarily even happening at that time. It's the device reports back to the OS, yes, I've written it, but it may have only written it to a buffer, which is like memory on the hardware. And then later it will write it to the actual magnetic part of the disk that is persistent when you turn off the machine, right? So when you do a flush, when a program does a flush, it not only tells the OS to flush the copy that the OS has in physical memory, it also tells the OS to issue an instruction to the disk to tell the disk that if it has a copy in its memory, it needs to also flush that to the actual magnetic medium, right? So in general, pages could be either a page in physical memory. It can be file-backed, meaning that it can be reloaded from a file, like its code. Usually it's code, either an executable file or a shared library. When we evict that file, we can discard the page, or it could be also be file-backed, but not be reloadable from a file. Actually, that's a third case maybe I haven't written here, where you're caching a file, but you're actually writing to the file. In that case, when you evict it, you can't just discard it. You need to write the copy to the actual file system, to the magnetic medium. So I mean, these bullets are a little bit misleading. I'll fix that. But then, the classic type of page we've been talking about is anonymous pages. They're just chunks of memory that the processes are using. And those ones, certainly, you do have to save those to swap space if you're evicting that memory, because you can't just copy it back from a file. You can't reload it back from a file. Right? Okay. Questions so far? Okay. So here's a kind of summary of some of what's going on here. So on the left-hand side, I'm showing the programmer's view. When I say programmer, I really mean like the compiler, or like the assembly programmer's view. Like when you're actually programming, you usually are not working with registers. But think of it as the compiler's view of the machine. You have registers that you can access directly by using the names of the registers. You have virtual memory, which you can access by either using a move instruction with an address, like move the copy of this address into a register, or very commonly by using the stack, pushing and popping onto the stack. Stack is in virtual memory. And then you also have the disk, which you can access by using usually these three system calls, open, read, and write. Right? You specify, the file name when you open, and then that gives you a reference, a file descriptor, which you can use to read and write off of, right? But what the OS wants to do is optimize, I guess, every one of these types of, especially these bottom two types of data accesses, and also share things across many processes. So we know that the OS keeps copies of registers for every different process, which it switches on a context switch, and then it takes physical memory and divides it among, this is a little sloppy, I know, but I have different processes, so this is showing physical memory that is split into sections dedicated to various virtual memory segments and also disk pages. So like process 3 might have some memory up here, there might be a file that's cached here, process 2 might have some memory, physical memory here, and then there might be a second file here that's cached, there might be some free space and another process, and the kernel might have some memory at the bottom. And then finally, when the OS uses the disks, both the swap space and the file system, to store, you know, overflow of memory, that's what these P3, P2, these are different processes, virtual memory pages that have been swapped out, but also executable files that perhaps have not been loaded yet into memory, even though that the program requests that they were loaded, those could be in the file system, right? So, like I said, the OS is trying to allow the program to be written in the simplest way possible so that it uses, the program uses disk when it just needs persistent access, but by allowing that disk data to be loaded into memory, the OS can make those accesses very fast. And of course, there's more complication to this picture because the CPU also has some optimizations at a lower level for the physical memory, right? So we know the CPU has an L1, L2, and L3 cache where it figures out which parts of the physical memory are most recently being used, and it puts those very close to the CPU. So actually, in some sense, the disk accesses that a program is making could actually be happening in an L1 cache, which is very small and basically as fast as the registers. So even though you're writing to a file or reading from a file, because of the optimizations at the OS level and at the CPU level, that access can happen almost as quickly as working with a register if it's in an L1 cache. If both the file, the OS has decided to cache that file in memory, and that memory has been used recently enough that the CPU has put that memory in an L1 cache, or an L2 and L3 are pretty fast too. Right? Okay, so the benefits here of file system caching are, of course, performance, but also allowing programmers to focus on functionality rather than performance and getting the performance for free, right? So the programmer just has to write data to disk if it needs it to be persistent, and the programmer does not have to worry about the speed of the disk because the OS will somehow make it seem fast. And like I said, accessing a file can be almost as fast as accessing a register if the disk block is stored in an L1 cache, which could happen, you know. Only a little bit of the disk could be stored in L1 cache, but could definitely happen. Although, I mean, there will be some overhead for the read and write system calls. So that's not entirely true. That you shouldn't take it with a grain of salt that I'm saying it could be as fast as an L1 cache, because to do a read or write, you actually will have to do a system call, which transfers control to the kernel and then back. So there's some overhead there, but still, it ends up being a lot faster to access the file than you might think otherwise. And certainly, like an XV6 that doesn't have any of this stuff compared to a modern operating system, is a big difference in performance. Yeah. I don't think your compiler will ever optimize code at that level. You're talking about taking, like, looking at, if you write code that, for example, does two reads or two writes in a row that logically could have been turned into a one bigger read, it would be very difficult and dangerous for the compiler to make the decision that those things are equivalent. And there's some cases where probably they're not totally equivalent, and like, you actually would want them to not be joined. But, I mean, I think that in the long run in computing, that's the direction where things are going. Like, the more the compiler's being smarter and having more knowledge of what the programmer's intention is and doing more optimizations and also having more control over what the OS and the hardware are doing. Yeah, right now as a programmer, it does make a difference, I think, whether you do two small writes or one big write. I'm showing here like that the OS will still try to make things fast by caching, but if you know ahead of time what the behavior is going to be, like that you're actually going to use all the data, then it's better to do it all at once in your program, I would say, yeah. Okay, so I'm going to switch gears, unless anyone has any other questions about like swapping, and we have 15 minutes, or at least 10, 12 minutes, up to 15 minutes, to potentially take questions on the practice midterm, or or just the midterm topics in general. So I'll start off by just asking anyone if they had questions about the questions on the practice midterm. And if not, I will just kind of go through some of what I thought were trickier parts of them. Right. Nope. All right. So for this fork question,
see all the code.
Yeah. Right. I love this technology. It's so cool. So the thing with these questions is that you have to remember that when there's a fork, that it creates a clone of the process that executes at that exact same point, and that it has like all the variables that were set before the fork are still gonna be set exactly the way they were when the fork, after the fork in both of the processes. The only difference between the two processes as they continue, so after we get to this point here where the fork happens, you'll have two processes running here, but one of them, but they'll just have different values for the return of the fork function. So this fork result number will be different. And it'll be, usually it's either zero if it's the child process, or it's equal to the process ID of the child process in the parent. Although in this case, we're not using that ID. So this else clause catches it. The only other option is, you should remember, is that the fork can fail. And if it does fail, it'll return -1, which is not a valid process ID. And you know the reasons it could fail are numerous, but like an XV6, for example, it's a very simple operating system, and I think it only allows like 64 processes to run at any given time. So if you have more than 64 processes, it'll fail. But you know, also if you run out of memory, that could be another reason. Yeah. So in most cases, the execution will continue here for both the child and parent, and the child will execute this code, the parent will execute this code below. So this is parent. No, sorry, that's child. And this is parent. And the interesting thing about this, the only other remaining interesting piece is that after the fork, you have two processes in the system that can be scheduled, and the OS can decide to schedule either one of them at any time. Like it's not just initially that has a decision of one or the other, but as they go along, the scheduler could be invoked to swap them for whatever reason. So you can't trust that any one of the two processes is going to finish before the other one does, or that any one is going to start before the other. You have to assume that they could be interleaved in any possible way, like they could be mixed up. I mean, they're always going to proceed sequentially. Each process individually is always going to proceed sequentially, but it could be paused at any time for another process to start making progress, right? So the tricky bit with this one was that there's this wait instruction, wait system call, which causes a process to wait for one child to finish. And this is all documented down here. So so if I give you one of these questions, I'll give you something like this to explain the system calls. You don't have to memorize that. Yeah, but if there are no children, it'll return, I think, minus one or zero. What does it say? Minus one. It'll return minus one if there are no children. So it's actually possible in the parent for this either to return the ID of the child or to return minus one. Because either if this parent executes first, then the child will be running, and when it runs wait, it'll block, and it'll actually, the parent will block, and the child will get a chance to run, and when the child finishes by exiting, then this call will complete, and it'll return the ID of the child. But if instead the child is scheduled first here, and the child does all its stuff, it prints out its count, and it finishes, if that happens even before the parent gets a chance to run, then when the parent runs wait, there'll be nothing to wait for. There'll be no children. And so it'll return minus one. And so this print instruction may or may not actually get called. Great. Yeah, question? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. If I had many print statements instead of just one, then the possibility for different outputs would be exponential. I mean, there would be every possible interleaving of those instructions would be possible, and so there would be many choices for like answers that you'd have to write out. So I wouldn't ask you to list every. You know, if each one was printing out five things, and they were both running in parallel, there'd be a lot of different. I wouldn't ask you to list out every possibility. But yes, they could. You should assume they can switch at any time. Yeah. Here. Yeah. So it could have scheduled the child. The child could have incremented count, and then it could have switched to the parent. But that doesn't. Whether or not it switches here or here won't affect the output, because as soon as the parent runs, it'll wait for the child to finish before it prints anything. If there was a printf statement up here, then yes, there would be a difference depending on whether the child was able to proceed all the way through the printf before the reschedule. Yeah. So these can be a little bit tricky. Any other? Yeah. Ah. Yeah, so it's possible for printf to not be atomic in the sense that like one process could start printing out like half a line and then another process could be scheduled. You know, I'm not sure what's causing that, but that behavior is certainly real. So if you have multiple processes running using the same like standard out this file descriptor and they're both writing to it, it can definitely like interleave. I wouldn't. I'll add a little note to this question. But yes, you shouldn't. That would make the question harder and more painful. But that is a real behavior that can happen. Okay. What else would be interesting to talk about? So for scheduling, for this problem here, this was kind of slow and complicated. Did anyone actually work this out yet, like on their own? So I think that if I were to ask this on the exam, it would be a little bit shorter, because there's a lot of like bookkeeping in order to do this, and there are also a lot of assumptions you have to remember. So first of all, you should read all these assumptions, because every one of them I think influences the scheduling. But what I did in the solution, you can kind of see a good way of approaching this kind of a problem, which is to just start building a timeline, but also keep track of which queues the processes are in over time, and when they change, you have to move them. And keep track of how much time has been used by each process at each step to decide whether or not it needs to move to a different queue. So basically, what happened here was that we had 1, 2, and 3, and One was CPU bound, all it did was compute for 200 milliseconds, and two was mostly I/O bound, and three was a mix. And we start everyone's high priority first. We round robin them, 1, 2, 3. So the assumption said that we should start with 1 and go to 2 and 3. Otherwise, everyone would have different answers. But the point is that 2, this says 15 here. So there's only 5 milliseconds that 2 runs before it blocks. And then I have a timeline here showing that from time 15 to 115, it is blocked on I/O. And then during that time period, 3 and 1 can use the CPU just between those two, right? So 3 runs for 10 seconds and 1. And then once 1 runs a second time, you have to compute at that point how much time has been used by that CPU at that run level. In this case, it's 28 milliseconds. So we know that the max time at that level is 20 milliseconds. So process 1 drops down to priority 2 at time 35. Here, right? So then for just this little segment from 35 to 45 between these two, we have process 3 in the high run level, but then once it uses another 10 seconds, 10 here plus 10 here puts it down at the second priority level as well. But then through this segment here, for the next little while, these two processes run round robin because although there is a higher priority process, this process is blocked. It's not runnable.
Okay.
So the only change occurs at, and this time isn't long enough for either of these to use up their 50 milliseconds to drop to the lower level, but eventually, like somewhere around here, they do. But basically, once 2 comes back, finishes its I/O, it's now runnable, and it's still in the higher priority level, so 2 definitely gets scheduled, right? But then it blocks again, and so on, right? So that's the strategy I used to write the solution, I guess. Just building out this table, and then every time I make a scheduling decision, obviously, like, choosing the process from the highest level that is actually runnable. But when 2 isn't runnable here, I have to go down to 1 or 3. And then when we finish a time slice, or when we do when there's an I/O that happens, we kind of check this list to see like how much computation processes have left before they need to do I/O. And when they are finished, also check to see how much time they have left on that run level before they have to be bumped down. Right. Yeah, we're about out of time, so I'll just stop here and answer if there are any questions. This stuff. Okay. I have office hours today, as usual, and I'll see you on Thursday. And don't forget, the project number 2 is due on Monday.